Christ, and thank you for tuning in. And like always, we never take anything for granted, but we are extremely happy. Bible study has been going great. Today, we are going to talk about the seals of God. We're going to go to the book of Revelations chapter, we're going to pick it up in chapter 5. Revelations chapter 5, verse number 1. If you have been studying with us at any period of time, we truly believe in teaching the Word of God chapter by chapter, verse by verse, but also getting, doing our best to encourage people to get into the Word of God. And like always, like we say, there's nothing like the Word of God. When you begin to study the Word becomes life to you. It becomes secondary nature. So also, if you go to the book of Revelations, when we open up the book, we're going to talk about the seals are not in chronological order, but the trumps are. So you'll be able to pick up this 666 talking about the mark of Satan. And also, as you know, through the word of God, we know that Jesus Christ will come on the seventh trump. Okay, so in case you have never studied with us, we definitely encourage you just to grab your Bibles and let's get into the Word of God and a word of wisdom from our Heavenly Father. In Jesus' name, amen. We're going to start with Revelation chapter 5, verse number 1, and it reads, and remember, we're talking about the seals of God. And I saw in the right hand of him that sat on the throne a book written within and on the backside, sealed with seven seals. Seven seals. Remember, the number seven means spiritual completion. The seven seals. And I saw a strong angel proclaiming with a loud voice, who is worthy to open the book and loose the seals thereof. Verse number 3. And no man, now listen to what the Bible says, and no man nor in earth, when we're talking about in the earth, we're talking about the followers of Satan, neither under the earth was able to open the book, neither to look therein. Now, you got to keep in mind that when we do this, we're talking about you would have to actually go to chapter 2, and then we'll pick it up in later chapters, the key of David, because as we mentioned in our last lectures, when the key of David was actually there, you saw the birth of Jesus Christ. And we also taught last week that the birth of Jesus Christ was not on December 25th. The birth of Jesus Christ was actually September 29th. Conception took place December 25th, and then it goes all the way back to the book of Daniel talking about the nativity. So all of these things, when you're talking about a seal, you're talking about something that's locked in the mind, is sealed in the mind. Truth. Remember, Jesus stated that the truth, if you know the truth shall do what? The truth shall set you free. And that's why we do these Bible studies, to encourage you to know the truth that stands, because no matter what you see in the world today, if it's not true, sooner or later, it's going to collapse, I guarantee you, all right? So, verse number four, and I wept much because no man was found worthy to open and read the book, neither to look thereon. That's a sad state of affairs, okay? Verse number five, and one of the elders saith unto me, weep not. Behold, the lion of the tribe of Judah, to the root of David, has prevailed, to open the book and to loose the seven seals thereon. Now, who can loose the seven seals? Our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Verse number six. And I beheld, and lo, into the midst of the throne and of the four beasts. Now, when you think of these beasts, don't think of these beasts as some grotesque monster. Our Heavenly Father, he uses symbolic words throughout, because that's the actions they're carried thereof. The beast. And in the midst of the elders stood a lamb as it had been slain, having seven horns and seven eyes, which are the seven spirits of God sent forth unto all the earth. Now, I'm going to read this in the original manuscript so individuals don't get lost, okay? Starting with the word stood in verse number six. Stood a lamb as it had been slain, having seven horns and seven eyes. This is symbolic to God's elect 7,000. Which are the seven spirits, the seven holy spirits of God, was sent forth. And then you will pick this up in Zechariah chapter 3, verse number 4. Or if you read Zechariah, the complete chapter of 3 and 4, you'll see where it talks about God's elect. So if you're if you're just not tuning in, we're not trying to throw a lot at you, but it's very, very important because we are living in the last days, and Jesus Christ, he will be returning in this generation because this is the generation of the fig tree. Anytime after 1948, and after 1948 AD, this is the year of the fig tree. So this is the year that we will see the Lord in this generation. We will see the Lord Jesus Christ. He will appear. We are in the fifth trump. If you don't know what the fifth trump is, we're going to tell you. The fifth trump is for true teaching. That's the signal. That's a benchmark for true teaching. On the sixth trump, Satan appears as Christ, as Jesus Christ. That's why we call him the Antichrist. The Greek makes it very clear. Instead of Christ, on the seventh trump, pay close attention, on the seventh trump, our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, he will return. How will you know this? Because in the twinkling of an eye, you'll be changed into your spiritual body. All right, so let's go. Verse number 7. And he came and took the book. What book did he take? He took the Bible out of the right hand of him that sitteth on the throne. And because this was his father's word, we're talking about Jesus Christ. And when he had taken the book, the four beasts and the 24 elders fell down before the Lamb, having one of them harps and golden vials full of odors, which are the prayers of the saints. God hears all prayers. In other chapters in the book of Revelation, you'll hear they're bottled up. It's very important to know. I keep saying this over and over, and sometimes it sounds repetitive, but it's important to know. Just think in your mind. Go back to remembrance. Have you ever believed that you had a destiny in Jesus Christ? Have you ever believed that there's something that our Heavenly Father wanted you to do? And you're living in this earth age, this earth, this time right now. Daniel wanted to live in this time. Zephaniah wanted to live in this time. Isaiah wanted to live in this time. Jeremiah wanted to live in this time. The reason being is because we're in the fifth trump to teach God's people for the sixth and for the seventh trump. Okay? Keep in mind, the seven seals are not in chronological order, but the seven trumps are. Verse number 9. And the song, and they sung a new song, saying, Thou art worthy to take the book and to open the seals, therefore, for thou wast slain and hast redeemed us to God by the blood out of every kindred and tongue and the people of the nation. Well, let's go back. Let's do this. First of all, what song are we talking about? We're talking about the song of Moses. In the book of Revelations, you'll see that the saints, when they enter after the millennium and they're going into heaven, because now we're coming out of the second earth age. We didn't pass through the millennium. Why does God allow the millennium? 1,000 years. What is a priest's job to do? A priest's job is to teach. So now you have 1,000 years to where we will be teaching God's people, because remember, it wouldn't be fair if no one never knew the true word of God. And some people say, well, we have teachers all around. But if you have to ask yourself, are they teaching the true word of God? If there's a church almost on every corner and somebody's teaching something different, something's wrong, because once again, in 1 Corinthians chapter 14, 33, our Heavenly Father said he's not, I repeat, N-O-T, not the author of confusion. So it's either the Lord or us, and I'm going to say it's us as the people, because our Heavenly Father, he does not make mistakes. Okay, so the 1,000-year teaching is for the true word of God, and that's what the elect's job is to do, to teach in this fifth trump, to go to the millennium and teach, and then after the millennium, you will sing the song of Moses. You'll find the song of Moses in Deuteronomy chapter 32. If you start with verse 1, as an intro, but if my memory serves me correctly, it starts around verse 8. The Song of Moses, Deuteronomy chapter 32. And that's the song that we'll sing at the end of the millennium. Why? Because we're overcomers. All right? And in this particular time, you'll see that God's elect, there will be at this particular time, the 144,000. The 144,000 are nothing but witnesses. And the witnesses will be able to state that the Lord Jesus Christ, he did send his elect to teach us. And they will be the witness to the truth as it will appear throughout the millennium. So once again, if the Lord Jesus Christ has sent someone to you, could or could not be the elect, but if they are the elect, which are the saints of God, this goes all the way back to the first earth age. When I say the word saint, goes all the way back to the first earth age, because we're the ones that did not follow Satan, and we have a destiny in Jesus Christ today. All right? So we don't want you to be confused. I know we're throwing a lot at you. However, it's so important to know, because we don't want you to be lost, and we don't want you to follow Satan, and we don't want you to actually spiritually be in bed with Satan on the sixth trump. Okay? So we love you, and that's one of the reasons why we do this program, to encourage you to get into the Word of God. The Word of God is not going out of style. As a matter of fact, the book of Amos, chapter 8, verse 11, God says, I'm going to send a famine out in the world. The famine is not of bread and water, but it is the true teaching of Jesus Christ. So that people are still hungry for the Word, the true Word. All right, so here we go. Verse number 10, and it reads, and has made us unto our gods and priests, the elect, and we shall reign on earth. On earth means now, all the way through the millennium. Now, if you go to the book of Ezekiel, chapter 13, you're going to see chapter 13, go through 18 and through 20, you will see that God is against his people who teach them to fly. There's absolutely not going to be a rapture. We have work to do here on earth. Just look around. We just look around. There's no mystery. Look at all the chaos, the evilness between the four hidden dynasties. I will point out the four hidden dynasties. You have the financial, you have the educational, you have the political, and last but not least, you have the religion. In Zephaniah and Zechariah, they point out the four hidden dynasties. You see chaos within all four. Okay? Now, if God did not want us to know this, he would not have put it into the Word of God. And that's why it's up to us to get into his Word and to never stop. There's never no time wasted when you're studying our Heavenly Father's Word. But let me get back to reign through the millennium. A priest's job is only to teach. Whether you are called a priest, a pastor, a minister, a servant, it doesn't make a difference. Your only job now is to teach. We are in the fifth trump. When the sixth trump sound, you're not going to hear a loud boom or horn. It is a benchmark. It's a warning sign. When the sixth trump comes, you will know, because someone will say they're here to rapture you away. The word rapture is not even in, it's not even in the King James Version, nor is it in the original manuscript. It is not going to happen. You want to be prepared to follow the Lord Jesus Christ. Revelations 14 and 13, your works are the only thing that carries you through from here to heaven. So, with all that said, I don't want you to be confused. I know I keep pounding it, but it's my job as a teacher to make sure that you don't be lost in this world of darkness. Look, we're all here to glorify the Lord Jesus Christ. After the millennium, everything, and the Bible talks about the rudiments and the elements, everything that's not of God will be washed away. We'll be totally destroyed. And you and I and everyone else that remains with our Heavenly Father will not have no remembrance of that. Why? Because we will live and reign in eternal life. So anything that's not of God going into the eternity, we will not carry it with us. So that's why it's important for us to study the Word of God, to share it with our loved ones, and so that we know it for ourselves and to share it with others. Verse number 11, and behold, and I heard the voice of many angels around and about the throne, and the beast and the elders, of the number of them was 10,000 and thousands of thousands. These were many that were washed in the robes and the blood of the Lamb. So whenever you say, well, we're working for the Lord and they're coming up against us, it doesn't make a difference. Remember, we lived in our spiritual bodies in the first earth age. We're here in the flesh, but we're going back to our spiritual bodies in the last earth age. If you want to call it the third earth age, it's okay. And when we talk about the robes and the linens, you'll be able to know throughout the millennium and eternity by what you're wearing is what you did to bring people and to teach people about the Lord Jesus Christ and bring them in to the true word of God. Okay? Verse number 12. Now, this is going to point out seven words, okay? So I want you to follow me very closely. Saying with a loud voice, worthy is the Lamb that was slain to receive one, power and riches, two, and wisdom, three, and strength, four, and honor, five, and glory, six, and blessing, seven. Once again, the number seven, spiritual completion. Look at the seven spirits that God released unto his elect. Is it beautiful? Absolutely. What are we to pray for? God, he automatically gives us power. And when he's talking about riches, he's talking about riches in the true word, not monetary gain. God will bless you if you do exactly what he called you to do. Trust me, he will do that. All right? But he reigns out on these seven spirits. And the seven spirits are only the ones of God's elect that will be able to receive this. He won't give this to the enemy. The enemy, that's not for the enemy. This is for God's elect, the true saints that followed him in the first earth age. And verse number 13, and every creature which is in heaven and on earth and under the earth, which is talking about Satan's followers under the earth, and such are in the sea, and all that are in them heard I saying, blessing and honor and glory and power be unto him that sitteth upon the throne and unto the Lamb forever. And I'm going to repeat forever and ever. And verse number 14, so we can continue. And the fourth beast said, amen. And the 24 elders fell and worship him that liveth forever and ever. So what is forever and ever? That's eternity. Think about it. It's eternity. Why? Because they did what the Lord had wanted him to do. And the Lord is, remember, the book of Revelation is our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. He took Saint John all the way to the third earth age to give him a vision of what it will be like to teach you and I today. Let's go to chapter 6, we're going to continue with the seals, but remember, the seals are not in chronological order. Verse number 1, and I saw when the Lamb opened one of the seals, and I heard as it were the noise of thunder, one of the four beasts saying, come in and see. It's open. Nothing hid. Lord Jesus Christ is saying, come in. It's open. Verse number 2, and I saw, and behold, I looked, a white horse, and he sat there on him, and had a bow, and a crown was given unto him, and he went forth conquering and to conquering. So let me help you out with this one, because I know in this writing it can be a little confusing. In the original manuscripts, this bow, we're not talking about the rainbow that was in the book of Genesis, because the Lord says, as long as you see the rainbow that will appear off and on, you will know that the Lord is still in heaven. And as you read in later chapters, Jesus Christ will sit on the right hand of the throne. So anytime, wherever you're at in this entire world, if you see a rainbow, you know that the Lord God, we're still in this flesh age, and he is still in charge. But this bow, in the original manuscripts, it talks about a cheap fabric imitation, not the true one. So let's read it the way it is. And I saw, and behold, I looked, a white horse, and he sat on him and had a bow, a cheap imitation, not the true, a false. And a crown. Anytime you see the word crown, you're looking for a king. Because, and this is a true scripture, of course it is. He is the king of darkness of this earth age. And he went forth conquering and conquering. And the reason why it says and conquering is because many will be deceived because they were not properly taught. Verse number 3. And when he had opened the second seal, I heard the second beast saying, come in and look. Now you notice he's still saying every seal that's open, come in. The book of, I don't know where people get this, that we're not supposed to study the book of Revelations, because the word itself means to unveil, reveal, make known. Verse number 4, and there went out another horse that was red, and power was given unto him that sat thereon to take the peace from the earth, and that they should kill one another. And there was given unto him a great sword. This is a fight against God's elect. In Mark chapter 13 and verse number 7. Mark 13 and 7. First, let me get back. Whenever you see the word red and you're talking about war, you're talking about Edom. And you're talking about Esau. And when you take Edom and Esau, what do you get? You get Rulah. And final and number 4, you get Russia. So just how Jacob said, for Jacob I loved and Esau I hated, there is a particular reason. Not that he hated the embryo, the small baby that was inside his mother's womb, but from the first earth age and what they did. So when you study the book of Revelation, take your time, go slow, chapter by chapter, verse by verse. But this verse is stating a fight against the war, a fight against God's elect. And if you look at the world today, Russia and the United States, there's going to be a conflict for a long period of time. All right? It's not going to change. Why? Because it's the Word of God. And when you study the Word of God, it's just like reading yesterday's newspapers. Verse number 5. And when he had opened the third seal, I heard the third beast saying, come in and see. And behold, and lo, a black horse, and he that sat on him had a pair of balances therein, in his hand. They're talking about the famine. Every time you see war, you see a famine that follows. All throughout God's word, anytime you've seen a war, you've seen famine that follows. Automatically, it has to happen in this earth age. Verse number 6, and I heard a voice in the midst of the four beasts saying, a measure of wheat for a penny, and 3 measures of barley for a penny, and see, thou hurt not the oil and the wine. Well, when you see the oil, you're going to see the oil is symbolic to our Lord Jesus Christ, the anointing oil. And when you say the wine, we're going to talk about the blood of Jesus Christ. Hey, once again, we got a lot more to study. I know that I keep throwing a lot out, but I'm excited about the word Jesus Christ. And I want you all to study his word. If you have any Bible questions, reach us at clevelandbiblestudy@yahoo.com. I'm Mike McDaniel. Until the next time, be blessed and stay in his word.